Hi everyone, my name is Aaron and welcome back to my channel. Today we're doing part two of Did L. Ron Hubbard Really Believe His Own Bullshit? I'll put a link up above to part one where I discussed why I believe L. Ron Hubbard did, at least by the end of his life, totally buy into his own BS. Today we're gonna discuss whether L. Ron Hubbard believed his own BS right from the beginning. I asked you to comment on part one. What are the things that you have heard about things L. Ron Hubbard said or did that would indicate to you he did not believe in what he was saying in Dianetics and Scientology in the early days? And then I would take up your comments in this video. So that's what we're gonna do. So here is by far the most common type of comment that I got from you guys on that video. Here's just a list of them. That he bet someone $1 million he could start a religion. He said, if you want to make real money, start a religion. He said, if you want to get rich, start a religion. If you want to get rich, start your own religion. If you want to become rich, start a church. Okay, so this is something that I've seen widely reported. Now, I personally have always taken this statement with somewhat of a grain of salt, mainly because it's just so much based on hearsay. But, you know, for the sake of this argument, let's just assume that this is a true story. Even if this is a true story, it's a somewhat common sense statement to make, whether you have any secret plans to start a church or not. I don't think this is a tremendously unique and insightful observation that if you really want to make a lot of money, start a church. Anyone can see that churches accumulate a lot of money and wealth. And I think it would be a bit of a stretch to draw a direct line between Hubbard making this statement, whether an offhand statement, a joke, to one of his buddies before he ever even wrote Dianetics. I think it would be a stretch to draw a direct line between making such a statement and then many years later creating what became Scientology and then what they then proceeded to pretend was a church. I mean, it is a bit on the nose. I know it's one thing to say, well, yeah, anybody could make such an observation, and yet not anybody who makes that observation then goes and creates an organization and actually calls it a church and actually gets the tax exemption and actually, you know, accumulates wealth to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars. So I do see the opinion of those who are like, it's not a coincidence the guy created a so-called church and, you know, a decade or however long it was prior was making a joke about such things. I certainly do see how people would make that connection. I'm just saying that to me, I've never gone, oh, that's the smoking gun. That's the smoking gun that LRH never believed anything he said right from the beginning. And the other reason this anecdote or this story has never really carried much weight with me is that I think it's worth pointing out that when L. Ron Hubbard wrote Dianetics, he wrote it not as a religious or a spiritual text. I mean, the full title of Dianetics is Dianetics, the Modern Science of Mental Health. And in that book, there is nothing of a spiritual nature. There is nothing about past lives. There is nothing about thetans, which, if you ask me, is the only reason Scientology even gets away with calling itself or passing itself off as a religion, is because you have this spiritual component, even though you don't have a God or a supreme being component. None of those components existed in Dianetics. According to L. Ron Hubbard, Dianetics was intended to be a straight-up scientific endeavor. So if Hubbard's sole motivation for doing Dianetics and Scientology was somehow a reflection of this thing he had said previously about either, you know, the real way to get rich is to start a church or a religion, or even having bet somebody he could start a religion. If what he did in Dianetics and Scientology was supposed to be a pure reflection of that, starting out with Dianetics wouldn't really make much sense. So then the question becomes, did L. Ron Hubbard really believe what he wrote in Dianetics when he wrote it? My personal opinion is that he did. Perhaps it takes someone who spent a lot of time in Dianetics and Scientology. You know, for those of you who may not be familiar, my mom got into Scientology when I was 4 years old. I was basically raised in Scientology. By the time I left Scientology at more or less the age of 34, I had spent over half of my life actually working for Scientology. Perhaps it takes someone who has spent that amount of time around the subject of Dianetics and Scientology to really appreciate how seriously L. Ron Hubbard definitely did seem to take everything he had written. I know it's hard just to take someone's word for it. It's easy to read Dianetics and be like, man, this is garbage. This is gibberish. Nobody could possibly believe this. But I think if you spend enough time around, not just the Scientology organization, but I guess I mean spending enough time listening to L. Ron Hubbard's lectures and reading everything he wrote for decades after originally having written Dianetics, there's really no question in my mind he took what he wrote very, very seriously. He would constantly refer back to it. He would correct people if they had misunderstood and misapplied it. He was relatively consistent in his development of the material, in referring back to earlier things. It's hard to give specific examples that would have much meaning for people who just aren't familiar with this subject, but I'm just telling you from my personal subjective opinion. Hubbard really did take his writings very seriously. And if you feel that, well, yeah, of course you would think that because that was part of the con, you know, he may not have not believed it and yet may have still been acting like he did. I'm just saying, if there's a difference of opinion on this, it might be something we can chalk up to, you know, someone who spent decades around this material is going to have a different opinion about this than someone who hasn't. Now, that being said, let me also point out this fact. I truly believe that even though I think Hubbard believed in, I think he believed that Dianetics was a form of a workable mental therapy. And yet I'll be the first one to tell you that the book Dianetics is absolutely packed with lies and falsehoods that Hubbard absolutely knew were lies and falsehoods. So perhaps we need to differentiate, or perhaps I need to be more specific on what I'm saying he believed and didn't believe. So for example, in Dianetics, it says Dianetics can cure all sorts of things that I have no question Hubbard never cured, not in himself, not in others. I believe that Hubbard is one of these personalities who, even when telling a story or an anecdote or reciting something that is actually based in fact, I think Hubbard is someone who cannot help but to embellish and exaggerate and lie about even something that is fundamentally true. And when I say true, I'm not talking about Dianetics. I'm talking about he could be telling a story about a fishing trip that actually occurred. And I think he would be almost incapable of telling a story about such events without exaggerating and without lying. So how this applies to Dianetics, there are things in Dianetics that are obviously false. I believe Hubbard knew they were false. And yet I believe that Hubbard believed that, hey, I created this thing that is at least moderately workable, that he believed was at least a moderately workable sort of a do-it-yourself at-home psychotherapy. But in order to really sell it and in order to really get people to buy it, I'm going to lie about it in this way and that way and the other way. So don't get me wrong, I think Hubbard was an inveterate and pathological liar. And yet I do believe that he believed that Dianetics was a form of mental therapy that did help some people some of the time. I'm not going to try to quantify how workable Hubbard thought it was, but I think he thought he had something valuable. And I think one of the pieces of evidence of that is that he did try to give or sell, or I guess pitch is probably the better characterization. He tried to pitch Dianetics to the APA and the AMA as this new magical, wonderful thing that all doctors and psychologists and psychiatrists should adopt in order to help their patients with all of their psychosomatic illnesses. I don't see how him attempting to pitch Dianetics to the field of psychotherapy and medicine, I don't see how him trying to do that is consistent with him not actually believing in the workability of Dianetics when he wrote it. And let's not forget that the fact that the APA and the AMA resoundingly rejected his offer of Dianetics really was the basis for his ongoing and lifelong vitriolic hatred of the field of psychiatry and psychology, and to a lesser extent, the field of medicine itself. And to piggyback on this, even when Hubbard did start to transition from just talking about Dianetics, which was very much just a this lifetime subject, The early days of Dianetics had nothing to do with past lives. It had nothing to do with spirituality. By the time Hubbard did start pivoting or transitioning into Scientology, even when he did so, he wasn't marketing it as a religion. He was calling it an applied philosophy. And then he started calling it an applied religious philosophy. And I can tell you that part of the appeals of Scientology in the early days was that it was like the anti-religion or the antithesis to religion. It was framed and marketed and presented as something that wasn't telling you that you had to believe in a God. It wasn't telling you that you had to worship. It wasn't telling you how to live your life. In the early days, Scientology was presented as really nothing more than a set of kind of common sense tools that you could apply to improve various conditions in your life, improve relationships, improve communication. This really was, and also there was an aspect of it where you were told, you know, you don't have to believe this just because it's written here and just because you're reading it or just because Hubbard wrote it. It was really, there was sort of an emphasis on the only parts of Scientology you have to believe are the parts, or the only parts of Scientology you should believe are the parts that you've tried for yourself, applied to your life, gotten a positive result with, and only then should you take anything in this material as true. This is really more how Scientology was presented in the early days, as like an antithesis to religion. And I believe marketing Scientology, selling Scientology that way, has a lot to do with why it was successful in the early days. Now, later on, for sure, as Hubbard progressed with the subject, and even it's even ironically gotten even worse under David Miscavige, Scientology has become a very dogmatic system that demands obedience and compliance and a particular way of believing, and they try to control who you can talk to and what information you can read and expose yourself to, you know, what websites you can read. It's become a very controlling organization, and I believe this is also part of why Scientology has contracted so much. I mean, at its height in the very late 80s, maybe early 90s, there was about 100,000 active Scientologists in the world. And these days it's much closer to 30,000 and likely below that number. So where I was going with that is that even when Hubbard started talking about Scientology, he still wasn't really harping on this religion angle. I really don't think that Hubbard cared about whether Scientology was viewed by anybody as a religion until it came time to worry about the tax issue. I don't think positioning Scientology as a religion helps Scientology make money. In other words, I don't think that Hubbard deciding to call Scientology a church contributed to people joining Scientology. I don't think calling it a church or calling it a religion or hoping the IRS would consider it a religion, I don't think that aspect of calling it a religion helped Scientology or helped Hubbard make money. In fact, I think calling it a religion creates a bigger obstacle to people joining Scientology in the first place. I think people are much more likely to want to get involved in something that's being marketed as an applied spiritual philosophy than somebody would be likely to join something that's calling itself a religion. That's my personal opinion. Now, whereas calling Scientology religion doesn't help you make more money on the front end, it certainly does help you hold on to more of that money on the back end in terms of not paying taxes. And I guess in my mind, I've always differentiated between these two things of, you know, the statement, the real way to get rich or the real way to make money is to start a religion. I've always felt that such a statement would refer to your ability to make money on the front end. And I think that statement is just a reflection of observing how much financial support people really do give to churches. But maybe, to be honest, maybe I've always been missing the point. Maybe Hubbard's point of the real way to get rich is to start a church, maybe that wasn't a statement that just reflects how much money churches take in. Maybe it really was a statement reflecting the fact that churches get to keep so much of that money due to tax-exempt issues. I've always looked at these two things as being separate, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe they are the same. But even if maybe I've been missing that point the entire time, I guess I would still like to point out that if the guy's mission was to start a religion to make money. He sure didn't execute on that very well, because it doesn't make sense to me that if that was your goal, that you would start with something you build and marketed as a science, and then you would progress to something that you build and marketed as a spiritual, an applied philosophy. And then only years on down the line would you be like, oops, we should really call this a church and pretend that we're a religion. I mean, even like, for example, in the current Scientology hierarchy of organizations, you have what's called a class 5 organization, and then under that you have what's called a mission. In the early days of Scientologies, the word mission didn't exist. Those organizations that are now called missions, they were called franchises. And for years and years and years, L. Ron Hubbard would write these policy letters referring to these organizations as franchises. And those policy letters still exist in Scientology today. And it wasn't until sometime later on down the line that he was like, oh, franchises sounds too much like a business. It sounds like a for-profit entity. We really need to start calling these missions. So even in the early days of what was actually, what was legally the Church of Scientology, he was still using very business-like terminology like franchises. So I guess, and I know I'm probably getting a little redundant on this issue, but I guess my point is that if he was really starting from day one to go, hey, I got this bet that I can start a religion made up of a bunch of BS and I can get a bunch of people to follow it, he didn't really execute very well on the path of getting there if that was his sole motivation from the beginning. And therefore, I'm just inclined to believe, based on the evidence in front of me, that the evidence tends to suggest that Hubbard did believe in the core fundamentals of what he was writing and selling, even back to Dianetics, even if he was making obviously false statements and false claims about what could really be achieved with Dianetics. And for sure, the same would apply later to his statements about Scientology. And let me know what you guys think about this other issue, and that is the massive amount of wealth that Hubbard did accumulate from Scientology during his lifetime. By the time Hubbard died, I believe he was worth something on the order of $600 million. And whatever he had, you know, I guess was bequeathed to the Scientology organization. And yet I've always sort of been fascinated by the fact that Hubbard had accumulated so much wealth, and yet by the time of his death was living in a trailer in the desert. If you're worth $600 million and you're trying to hide from various federal governments and agencies, and you're in seclusion, there are many much more better options on how to be living, where to be living, how to be hiding, than living in a trailer in the desert. And another data point that kind of correlates to the point I'm trying to make there with the trailer is that when Hubbard started the Sea Organization, he bought this, I would call it a giant ship, you know, compared to today's ships, it wasn't that giant. But it was a big ship. It might legally have been qualified as a giant yacht called the Royal Scotsman. He turned it into the Apollo. And that was, you know, a major thing in the early days of the Sea Organization, is L. Ron Hubbard and his core group of Sea Org members lived on this Apollo ship. Well, okay, Hubbard had to have a lot of wealth in order to buy the ship in the first place. But by all accounts, this ship was an absolute piece of shit. And on this ship, yes, Hubbard's quarters were certainly nicer, bigger, and more comfortable than the absolute garbage quarters that the rank and file Sea Org members occupied. And yet I believe by all accounts, those who were there on the ship with Hubbard would tell you, I believe they would say that his quarters were far from luxurious. And I want to know if you guys think I'm kind of making a meaningless distinction here, because this idea that even though Hubbard accumulated a lot of wealth, he did not live the lifestyle that you would expect of someone who had accumulated all of that wealth, that has always been something that stuck in my head, that tended to negate the idea that Hubbard was doing this all for money. I mean, I guess it's possible to be motivated to accumulate tons and tons of money even if you aren't living a lifestyle reflective of your net worth. But I'm just saying, the fact that he never lived like someone who had accumulated that much money has always been something that I've kind of, in my mind, has tended to negate this other point. Let me know what you guys think about that. Is this a distinction without a difference? Let me know what you think in the comments down below. Okay, the next most common comment and the last comment that I'll take up for this video, I didn't mean for this video to be a long one, but it looks like it might be getting that way. The next most common comment had to do with L. Ron Hubbard being a fiction writer or a science fiction writer or a fantasy writer. It says he was a fiction writer after all, so he's a really good storyteller. I heard that Hubbard was a science fiction writer. So I did a video on this, it was called something like, "Do Scientologists Realize L. Ron Hubbard was a science fiction writer?" And I'll put a link to it up above. Some people believe that Scientologists are clueless. Like, how can they not see and understand that the guy who created their so-called religion just happened to be one of the most prolific fiction writers of all time? Don't they see the connection there? And in the video, I discuss how Scientologists absolutely see the connection. They just see it completely oppositely. They see it in a completely different way than your average person would interpret those facts. They believe the reason Hubbard was able to be such a prolific writer is because he wasn't having to come up with storylines. He wasn't having to do all of the work a normal writer might do to build a story and come up with a story and put it together. They believe he was writing stories from his own personal experiences and his memories from past lives. Scientologists believe that we have all lived so many lifetimes that there's literally nothing that you have not done before. You have been a king, you have been a queen, you've been presidents of dozens of countries, you've been the CEO of massive businesses, you've been the emperor of galaxies, you've been anything you could possibly think of. They believe that Hubbard was able to tap into this recall of all of his previous experiences in his prior lives to write these amazing stories. So yes, they know he was a fiction writer. It's just not a deal breaker for them because they see that as a feature, not a bug. Okay, I lied. There is one more comment I'm going to take up, and it has to do with, well, it says here, L. Ron Hubbard was quoted as saying that if you want to control people, all you have to do is lie to them. Yeah, this is something I've seen reported a bunch of times. The thing is, the context to this particular lecture he was given is always deliberately omitted. I think it's a shame. I think when you're trying to criticize and target Scientology, it's much better to stick to the facts and provide the context. There's plenty enough to criticize without omitting things to make things seem worse. This lecture where L. Ron Hubbard said this was a lecture he was giving to Scientologists. Remember what I said earlier about in the early days of Scientology, Scientologists really saw Scientology as being like the antithesis to status quo religion. Hubbard would bash religion all the time in his lectures. He would bash the way religions, for example, control people. And in Hubbard's perspective, and in the perspective of Scientologists, religions, and not just religions, this applies to other groups, other movements, you know, political systems, things like that, control people by lying to them. Now somebody could go, well, yeah, but Hubbard understood that. He might have been saying that to Scientologists, but he also understood at the same time that that's what he was doing. And I'll grant that that's possible. I'm just saying this quote is not a smoking gun. This quote is not a gotcha. It's kind of like using a quote about, hey, the real way to get rich is to start a religion. It's like, yeah, anybody could say that, even somebody that wasn't planning on starting a religion. So this thing about the way to control people is to lie to them, all I got to say is not a smoking gun, not evidence that LRH didn't buy his own BS. So to wrap this up, the previous video I did was my argument for why I believe LRH definitely believed his own BS at the end of his life. And this video is my argument for why I actually do believe that Hubbard believed his own BS even in the beginning. And yet I also believed that he knew he was making BS claims. He was absolutely saying things he knew wasn't true. It's just that I believe that he believed in the core of what he was doing. I think the evidence suggests that. If you guys have other items pertaining to this subject that you want me to take up or respond to, let me know in the comments down below. I'd be more than happy to do a part three on this subject. I find conversations surrounding this whole thing to be very interesting and a lot of fun. So if you have items you want me to take up that I didn't cover in part one and part two, put them down below and I'll do a part three. But hey, before I sign off, have you heard I am running for city council in Clearwater, Florida, home of the largest Scientology organization in the world? If you think Clearwater should have a council member willing to take action against Scientology's human trafficking, crimes against children, and crimes against the elderly, if you want Clearwater to have a council member who will not rest until Scientology's tax-exempt status is revoked, then please consider supporting my campaign at aaronforclearwater.com. Thank you, everyone. Thank you to all of you who watch until the very end, and I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye.
Okay, if you want to see my rock and roll songs, click right on this guitar. And if you want to see a different one of my videos, then you could click right inside here. If you have subscribed or not, subscribe right here. Bye!